Exodus chapter 15. The story is continuing on. Started from chapter 1, now we're into chapter 15. We're going to be talking about 15, 16, and a portion of 17 this morning. I don't know if you noticed, but all the songs we sang had a similar theme. They focused on the same person, and that person is Jesus Christ. He's the reason why we're gathered here this morning. He's the reason why we are a people in the first place, why we are the church. He's the one who has given us his Spirit. Everything is about Christ. And if at any point you start getting the sense that what we're doing here on a Sunday morning isn't about Christ, that's when you need to come up to me or somebody of the elders and be like, hey, are we still focusing in on Christ? Because this is what we're all about. We exist to spread a passion for the glory of King Jesus. And at any point, if this is not about King Jesus, then we're missing it. But I love gathering here every Sunday to focus on and worship Jesus Christ with you. We are a corporate body, the body of Christ, giving glory to the King, Jesus Christ. That's what we're all about. And that's what Scripture is about. It's what this word is about. It's what the whole story of the Bible is about. It's about Christ and Christ alone. And we're going to see that in this text as we look at the journey of Israel and the story of Israel as they are in the desert. As they're in the desert. I don't know if you've ever had any experience with parenting, but if you're a parent in this room, you're gonna understand a lot more about this text just by virtue of your experience. Because in this text, it's almost like God is a father. In fact, he is a father. Not almost like. He is a father. And Israel is his child. He calls Israel his firstborn son. And he almost births the nation through blood and water, through the sea and through the Passover lamb. And they're a newly formed, new creation child, if you will. And in the desert, you have them acting like young children. They're born, and now they're in this kind of young children stage of their life as a nation. And it actually is going to, they're going to continue to grow, and God's going to continue to teach them. And you're going to get to Numbers, if you keep reading through Exodus, through Leviticus, into Numbers. The Numbers text, they start taking on the form of that rebellious teenager. That kind of adolescent stage, right? Where it's no longer complaining and grumbling. It's like resistance and rebellion. And you got to recognize, Israel's kind of on a journey here. They're God's people. It's God's child. And he's training them up. He's teaching them what it means to be his children. What it means to be his people. What it means for him to lead them and for them to trust him and obey him. And so we've seen that God has graciously called them out of slavery. He's redeemed them from slavery, and now they're journeying to the promised land. They did nothing to receive that grace of God. They were slaves in Egypt. They had nothing. They could do nothing. And God says, I'm going to save and rescue you by my mighty hand. And you will know that I am your God, and I will be your God, and you will be my people. I have rescued you. I have redeemed you. And Israel is just along for the ride. And now as God has poured his grace on Israel and they've been redeemed from slavery, now they are being taught by God as their father how they are to live. How life with God as their father, with God as their God, with the Lord Yahweh as the one who is present with them and involved with them, how they are to be as a people. And the desert narratives are a stage in this journey of Israel's life. And so the main idea of this text as we look at it, oh, you know what? Joel, that slide is from my message last week, so I might have downloaded the wrong one. Yeah, so we can just forget the PowerPoint. That's good. Yeah, or the whatever that's called. Yeah, all right. So, because those are going to be the, I don't want to preach the same message from last week. So, but here's the main idea. Despite Israel's rebellious grumbling, the Lord lovingly tests and patiently provides for his people to teach them how to obey and trust him. Despite Israel's rebellious grumbling, the Lord lovingly tests and patiently provides for his people as he teaches them how to obey and trust him. And there's kind of three sections here. The first section, they're going to come up to this bitter water spot, and they're going to complain and grumble, and God's going to make the water clean. The second section, they're getting hungry, and they want bread, and they want meat, and God provides them with manna and quail. And in the third section, they come to another spot in the desert, and there's no water, and God has Moses strike a rock, and he gives the people water through a rock. And we're going to see the journey here as we look at the text. So read with me in chapter 15, verse 22. Exodus 15, 22. Then Moses led Israel from the Red Sea, and they went into the desert of Shur. For 3 days they traveled in the desert without finding water. When they came to Marah, they could not drink its water because it was bitter. That is why the place is called Marah. So the people grumbled against Moses, saying, "What are we to drink?" Then Moses cried out to the Lord, and the Lord showed him a piece of wood. He threw it into the water, and the water became fit to drink. There the Lord issued a ruling and instruction for them and put them to the test. He said, if you listen carefully to the Lord, your God, and do what is right in his eyes, if you pay attention to his commands and keep all his decrees, I will not bring on you any of the diseases I brought on the Egyptians, for I am the Lord who heals you. Then they came to Elim, where there were 12 springs and 70 palm trees, and they camped there near the water. Okay, so the first test here is that they come up to this place of bitter water. And when they come and they realize the water is undrinkable, the people grumble. They complain. And then the Lord provides. He throws a piece of wood into the water, and it actually is made clean, which is actually a miracle that Elisha does later in the storyline of Scripture. And then the Lord uses this provision. And he says, okay, here was the test. Here's the ruling now. Here's how you're going to go forward, okay? You're going to listen to my decrees. You're going to obey my commands. You're going to, I won't, if you do this, I won't bring on you the plagues of Egypt. So it's pretty significant to not. And he instructs them and he tests them. So let's put some things in perspective here. The people are grumbling against Moses, right? That's what the text says. They're grumbling against Moses. But think back with me on the storyline. Who's been leading them? What have they been following? They've been following the Lord in what form? In a pillar of cloud and fire. The Lord has been leading and guiding his people this whole time through a pillar of cloud and fire. And you see through the book of Exodus, the Lord continually appears to them in the cloud. And so when they are complaining against Moses, who are they really complaining against? God. They're complaining against God who led them to that spot, as they know Moses is just following the Lord. They know Moses is just following the cloud. And so when they come to Moses and they're like, Moses, what's up with this, man? What are you doing here? They're not just complaining against Moses. They're complaining against God. It's an act of rebellion to actually complain and grumble about where God is leading them. And then why is the Lord testing Israel? Why the test? I think sometimes we see that word test and we think like a teacher, you know, who's like this really cruel teacher who's ready to come and he's going to give you a test and he can't wait to mark it up in red, you know, like, here's your test, good luck, you know, and you get in there and you're like, I don't know the answers. And then afterwards he's like, it's like a pass-fail grade and he's like, fail, you know, I don't know. Are there teachers that delight in that? I don't know. Probably not. But I feel like from a student's perspective, sometimes it feels that way, right? Sometimes you would get a test back and you felt like, does the teacher enjoy marking up this paper with red? Like, it was really good, but they just wanted to have something to write down, so they put red on it and gave me a B or something. Like, you know, I'm sure we think that as students sometimes. But here's the point. God is not this, like, teacher who's just trying to see if his people will mess up or not. He's not just looking for a pass-fail grade. You've got to think of God as a father here. He's training his children in how to obey and trust him. He's about to get to Mount Sinai, where he's really going to explain to them what they need to do in order to be his people. But right now, he's giving them some tests, saying, this is what it looks like to obey and trust me. And we get this as parents. Every young child loves touching things they're not supposed to. Take electrical sockets, for example. Right? Children naturally possess the unique ability to locate the one thing in a room that could cause the most damage to them. Have you noticed that? Like, out of all the things you could grab in this room, you had to grab the knife or the scissors, or you had to go over to the electrical socket and see if your finger fits in it. I mean, it's like nature. It's weird. But when you're a parent of a young child and you're trying to instruct your children in what is going to be helpful for them and what is going to be harmful for them, you have two options. You have two options as a parent of a young child. Option one, you remove your child from the temptation or the situation of danger, right? So Ariel, my youngest, all right, she's almost 2 years old. She goes over to the electrical socket and is about to touch it. I could just be like, nope, over here, you know, lock her in the room, you know. I don't want her to be near that. I don't want her to hurt herself, and so I'm removing the temptation from her. That would be one way. The other option is I could actually come into that situation with her and work on teaching her what obedience and wisdom look like in the midst of the temptation and the situation. So I could go stand there by her and I could be like, Ariel, don't touch that socket. And she'll look at me. She'll look back at the socket. And then she'll look at me. You know, you've seen this on kids' faces. And you're like, Ariel, don't touch that socket. And sometimes if they're like Ariel, some kids are, some kids aren't. Sometimes they'll put their finger out, like, testing you, right? What are you going to do, Dad? What are you going to do? And so she'll stick her finger out, and I'll just kind of, like, flick her finger when it gets close. I'll be like, Ariel, don't do that. And she'll be like, you know, wait, what? You just flicked my finger, Dad. That wasn't cool, you know? And we'll have this little thing. But what am I doing in that moment? I'm not just removing her. I'm trying to teach her, look, Ariel, in this situation, you need to learn to obey my words and trust that I am looking out for your best interests, all right? I am simulating with a small, tiny flick what could be a barbecue, right? And so I want to train her and teach her not to do something. And so by doing that, sometimes via time, context, whatever, you just got to get them out. You just got to be like, you know what? Can't handle it right now. Nope, here we go, you know? But sometimes you get the chance to actually instruct them and teach them in what it means to obey and trust you. And parental wisdom is necessary to determine which option you choose for any given moment. But this is what God is doing with Israel. He's getting in with them, he's in their lives, and he's saying, look, I'm going to lead you to a place that is going to look difficult and dire and like it's a problem, and I want you to learn to obey me and trust me in the midst of this situation. Obey me and trust me in the midst of this situation. I am looking out for your good. He says in Exodus 20:20, Moses said to the people, do not fear, for God has come to test you, that the fear of him may be before you, that you may not sin. The reason why the Lord is testing them is because he's caring for their best interests. He's looking after them. He's saying, this is going to be the best pathway for you. Learn to obey and trust me. And as he goes through these stories, the testing of God is always for the benefit of the people. And the question is, will they, can they learn to trust God for their needs in the midst of dire circumstances? Can they trust God. Great. So the second thing that he does is we get to chapter 16, and it says, the Lord provides bread and meat. You can go to the next. Yeah, we got the slides up here. This is kind of the movement of the text in the desert tests. And now we're looking at where the Lord provides bread and meat, number two. Test number two. Okay, so the Lord has just sent the plagues. He's destroyed the Egyptians in a massive military victory by passing his people through a walled sea and swallowing Egypt in their grave. He's led them through a pillar by a pillar of cloud and fire. He's purified the water at Marah. Now Israel's going to get it, right? Now they're going to trust God when they hit another dire circumstance. Now they're going to learn what it means to obey and trust God. Let's see what they say. What it says in chapter 16, verse 3. The Israelites said to them, when they get to this and they realize they're hungry and there's no food, they say, if only we had died by the Lord's hand in Egypt. I mean, there we sat around pots of meat and ate all the food we wanted, but you have brought us into this desert to starve this entire assembly to death. This is Israel's attitude. They get there, there's nothing to eat, and they're like, oh my goodness, Egypt was so great. Slavery was the best. Remember those days when we had all the food and the bread we could eat? Now Moses has led us out into the desert, and we're all going to die out here. Might as well have just died in Egypt. That's their attitude as the people grumble. And the Lord responds to this. If you go down to verse 6, he says, as he speaks to through Moses and Aaron, he says, so Moses and Aaron said to all the people of Israel, at evening you shall know that it was the Lord who brought you out of the land of Egypt. And in the morning, you shall see the glory of the Lord, because he has heard your grumbling against the Lord. For what are we that you grumble against us? And Moses said, when the Lord gives you in the evening meat to eat and in the morning bread to the full, because the Lord has heard your grumbling that you grumble against him, what are we? Your grumbling is not against us, but against the Lord. And this is Moses' point. When the Israelites are grumbling in the desert, they're grumbling against the Lord. He is the one leading them. So what does the Lord do in response to their grumbling? Does he smite them? Does he take them out? Does he say, you know what, I'm done with you guys? No, he provides for them. Because he knows they're just young children learning to obey and to trust. And he cares for them, even in the midst of their grumbling. Exodus 16, verse 4 through 5. Then the Lord said to Moses, behold, I am about to rain bread from heaven for you. I don't know why that just always strikes me as so awesome. But like, I'm about to rain down bread. This is pretty sweet. This is pretty intense. This is God, another sign, another miracle of God's incredible provision. He is going to rain bread down on them. And the people shall go out and gather a day's portion every day that I may test them. Okay, so he's going to provide for them, but he's also going to test them. He wants them to learn how to obey and trust him. So he says, every day you're going to go out and you're going to collect bread for that day. And then on the sixth day, when they prepare what they bring in, it will be twice as much as they gather daily. So what's the test? The test is they have to gather enough for one day, and then on the sixth day, they gather enough for how many days? 2 days, because it's the Sabbath day, and they're not going to gather food on the Sabbath day. So think about what God's asking them. He's saying, you guys have to trust me every single day, right? If you're in an agricultural world, and you get a massive harvest of fruit or vegetables, you know that you want to collect as much as is collectible in that moment so that it lasts you for the days when you actually aren't having anything producing, right? But Israel doesn't get to work like that. They literally have to just get enough for the day and hope tomorrow there's food to eat. That's a pretty intense test. And yet they see God rain bread from heaven. And they're only supposed to collect enough for one day. So how do the people respond? Go to verse 19. Then Moses said to them, no one is to keep any of it until morning. However, some of them paid no attention to Moses. They kept part of it until morning, but it was full of maggots and began to smell, so Moses was angry with them. The way they responded to this, some people actually said, oh, we'll keep some for tomorrow morning and it'll be good then, and then what they come to find out is that it doesn't actually last that long. But they were disobedient. They didn't listen to what God's word said. They're still learning this process. And then he tells them, okay, get enough for 2 days now, because tomorrow's the Sabbath day. I'm not going to rain bread on you that day. And how do the people respond? How do some respond? Go to verse 27. Nevertheless, on the seventh day, some of the people went out to gather, but they found none. He said, there's going to be no food tomorrow. And then they wake up and they go out looking for food. It's like they're not listening. They're not listening to God. They're not listening to their Lord. Verse 28, and the Lord said to Moses, how long will you refuse to keep my commandments and my laws? See, the Lord has given you the Sabbath. Therefore, on the sixth day, he gives you bread for 2 days. Remain each of you in his place. Let no one go out of his place on the seventh day. So the people rested on the seventh day. Through this whole story, God is patiently teaching his children what it looks like to obey and trust him every single day, every single week. And Israel keeps grumbling. They're not getting it. They're like young children who can't learn the lesson. But the manna in this whole thing is symbolizing God's provision. Does God keep providing for Israel? Every day. Every day. He's testing Israel because he's teaching his people to trust him for daily provision. He's teaching his people to listen to his commands, and he's teaching his people to keep the Sabbath. He's getting them set up for Sinai when he gives them the law. He's trying to teach them that he is with them. He will provide for them. They can trust his word, and they can follow his commands. It's for their good. It's for their benefit. And then the last test is in chapter 17. The Lord provides water from a rock. Let's read that text together. The whole Israelite community, chapter 17. The whole Israelite community set out from the desert of Sin, traveling from place to place as the Lord commanded. They camped at Rephidim, but there was no water for the people to drink. So they quarreled with Moses and said, "Give us water to drink." Moses replied, "Why do you quarrel with me? Why do you put the Lord to the test?" They're actually turning the test back on God, saying, "Will you answer or not? Will you be here or not? Will you fix this or not?" But the people were thirsty for water there, and they grumbled against Moses. They said, "Why did you bring us up out of Egypt to make us and our children and livestock die of thirst?" Then Moses cried out to the Lord, "What am I to do with these people? They are almost ready to stone me." The Lord answered Moses, "Go out in front of the people, take with you some of the elders of Israel, and take in your hand the staff with which you struck the Nile, and go. I will stand there before you by the rock at Horeb. Strike the rock, and water will come out of it for the people to drink." So Moses did this in the sight of the elders of Israel, and he called the place Massah and Meribah, because the Israelites quarreled and because they tested the Lord, saying, "Is the Lord among us or not? Is the Lord among us or not?" That's the question they're asking. God has redeemed them from slavery in Egypt. He's led them by pillar and fire. He has constantly said over and over again to Moses and the people, "I will be with you, I will be with you, I will be with you." And yet they test the Lord continually, saying, "Is the Lord among us or not?" Their attitude is one of, "The Lord can't be among us. Look what we don't have. We don't have water to drink. We don't have bread to eat. Is the Lord really with us?" And they're not learning to trust. But despite Israel's rebellious grumbling, the Lord lovingly tests and patiently provides for his people to teach them how to obey and trust him. Why can't they get it? Why can't Israel remember all the great deeds of God on their behalf? Why can't they see? And I think sometimes we can be a little hard on Israel, you know? We can be a little hard on Israel. I think we need to kind of try to get ourselves in their situation, okay? So picture yourself traveling through the desert. The desert. I mean, I start complaining when it gets above 90 degrees, which it did yesterday, and I said something about it, and for that I must confess. But they're in the desert, and you see water, and you're thirsty, and you get there, and it's bitter. You can't drink it. You're looking at water, and you can't drink it. You look around, and there are thousands of people traveling with you, and there was no water for them either. And you just drank your last bottle. And your kids are constantly asking for something to drink. Daddy, I'm thirsty. 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 And you're like, shut up. And your babies are crying uncontrollably. And have you ever had a baby crying uncontrollably and you can't stop the child from crying? It's so taxing on the emotional, psychological portion of our lives. And mom is about to pull her hair out, and she's saying to her husband, well, I hope you're happy, dear. I said we should have stayed home. At least we had food and water there. At least we knew how to survive. At least we could feed our children. And the husband's response is like, okay, I'll go talk to Moses. And he goes to Moses and he joins the mob of fathers who are saying, Moses, we got mouths to feed here. We've got animals and children that need water. This is our livelihood. This is our future. And you've led us out here to die. I mean, we can understand their situation to a degree. They're literally dying out here. And it's quite easy to identify, I think. I mean, who of us has not complained about our present circumstances as if it was the end of the world? The Israelites forgot God's redemption and provision because they couldn't see past their present circumstances. In the midst of their dire circumstances, they forgot that God is above their present circumstances, that God is above them. And in doubting God, they put him to the test by saying, is the Lord among us or not? Is the Lord among us or not? Is God going to come through for us like we think he should? And the Lord who had said to Moses and the people over and over, I will be with you, is questioned the moment they hit a hard time or a difficult circumstance. In essence, they're saying, prove it, God, because your word and your actions on our behalf, they're not enough. We need you to prove it again. We need you to prove your presence with us again. And God responds to them with such patience, with such forgiveness, with such grace. He's teaching them, these little children of a nation, he's teaching them to trust and obey him. And in all of this, you're seeing the glory of the Lord. In all of this, you're seeing that the Lord is one who patiently provides. He patiently provides because that's who he is. He is a loving father. He provides for his people. But you also see here that he's teaching them. Now, let me just make a quick note here. When you get to Numbers 14, after they've been given the law and they're about to go into Canaan, and they say, there's giants in the land, we can't overcome, and they say, actually, let's stone Moses and Aaron and let's go back to Egypt. When that happens in Numbers 14, God has a different response. He has a different response to them in that moment. He says, yeah, you guys who are living, anyone who's 20 and older, you're going to die out here in the wilderness for your unbelief in me. You're going to wander around. Your children I'm going to take into the promised land. Because of Moses' intercession and prayer, God sticks with his people. But the people who complained and grumbled against God in Numbers 14 are then judged with a judgment of death as the wilderness becomes not just a place of testing, but a place of death. So don't think that there's not going to be consequences if they don't learn to trust and obey God. But right now, he's teaching them. And he's patient with them. And he's journeying with them. He's leading this newly formed young people, and he is displaying to them his glory. Notice verse 7 of chapter 16. It says, you will see the glory of the Lord. His provision for them is them seeing the glory of the Lord. He's providing for their needs despite their constant grumbling and quarreling. And so the main idea as you see this is that despite their rebellious grumbling, the Lord lovingly tests and patiently provides for his people to teach them how to obey and trust him. So how does this apply to us? I just started this whole talk saying that everything we talk about here, everything we do here is about Jesus Christ. So what does this story have to do with Jesus? And I think it has everything to do with Jesus. And I know that because the Bible tells me that. Turn in your Bibles to John chapter 6. If we were to ask the question, does the Lord provide for us? Does the Lord provide for us as his people? Can we trust him to provide for us? John chapter 6 clearly lays out how it is that he provides for us. This is at the feeding of the 5,000. And chapter 6 verse 5 says, when Jesus looked up and saw a great crowd coming toward him, he said to Philip, where shall we buy bread for these people to eat? Why did Jesus ask him that? Verse 6, he asked this only to test him. So now Jesus is the one testing in the midst of this lack of bread that this crowd is experiencing. He said he asked this only to test him, for he already had in mind what he was going to do. And so we see this scene playing out. They go away. They come back. He feeds the 5,000. And then later he talks about it. Go to chapter 6, verse 25. Now, I'm not going to explain much of this text. I just want you to read it with me, and I want you to hear it after we just heard the story of Israel in the desert, okay? Because it's referenced in this text. So read with me John chapter 6, starting in verse 25. When they found him on the other side of the lake, they asked him, Rabbi, when did you get here? Jesus answered, very truly I tell you, you are looking for me, not because you saw the signs I performed, but because you ate the loaves and had your fill. Do not work for food that spoils, but for food that endures to eternal life, which the Son of Man will give you, for on him God the Father has placed his seal of approval. Then they asked him, What must we do to do the works God requires? And Jesus answered, the work of God is this, to believe in the one he has sent. So they asked him, what sign then will you give that we may see it and believe you? What will you do? Our ancestors ate the manna in the wilderness, as it is written, he gave them bread from heaven to eat. Jesus said to them, very truly I tell you, it is not Moses who has given you the bread from heaven, but it is my Father who gives you the true bread from heaven. For the bread of God is the bread that comes down from heaven and gives life to the world. Sir, they said, always give us this bread. Then Jesus declared, I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never go hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty. But as I told you, you have seen me, and still you do not believe. All those the Father gives me will come to me, and whoever comes to me I will never drive away. For I have come down from heaven, not to do my will, but to do the will of him who sent me. And this is the will of him who sent me, that I shall lose none of all those he has given me, but raise them up at the last day. For my Father's will is that everyone who looks to the Son and believes in him shall have eternal life, and I will raise them up at the last day. And this, the Jews there began to grumble. Jesus tells them, Moses gave you bread from heaven, I'm the bread of life, and their response to Jesus in saying this is grumbling. They grumble about him because he said, I am the bread that came down from heaven. They said, "Is this not Jesus, the son of Joseph, whose father and mother we know? How can he say, 'I came down from heaven'?" And Jesus says, "Stop grumbling among yourselves. No one can come to the Father. No one can come to me unless the Father who sent me draws them, and I will raise them up at the last day. It is written in the prophets, they will all be taught by God. Everyone who has heard the Father and learned from him comes to me. No one has seen the Father except the one who is from God. Only he has seen the Father. Very truly, I tell you, the one who believes has eternal life. I am the bread of life. Your ancestors ate the manna in the wilderness, yet they died. But here is the bread that comes down from heaven, which anyone may eat and not die. I am the living bread that came down from heaven. Whoever eats this bread will live forever. This bread is my flesh, which I will give for the life of the world." Jesus is the bread of life. He is the ultimate provision for our needs. He is the one who meets our every need. So that we come here and we gather and we sing songs saying, "All I have is Christ." It's because Jesus is the bread of life. He is the one who meets our needs. He is the presence of God with his people. Keep reading in verse 53. Jesus said to them, "Very truly, I tell you, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you. Whoever eats my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life, and I will raise them up at the last day. For my flesh is real food, and my blood is real drink. Whoever eats my flesh and drinks my blood remains in me, and I in them. Just as the living Father sent me, and I live because of the Father, so the one who feeds on me will live because of me. This is the bread that came down from heaven. Your ancestors ate manna and died, but whoever feeds on this bread will live forever." Okay, that's a weird text, right? And anytime some dude's talking about eating my flesh and drinking my blood, that's a little unique, right? But Jesus is making a point within the Old Testament context. He's saying in the wilderness, they ate manna from heaven and drank from the rock. And I am the bread of life. I am the rock. I am the one you come to when you are hungry or you are thirsty. And if you come and partake of my life, Jesus says, you will never die. You will live forever. You won't be like Israel who die in the wilderness, but you will come to know eternal life because I am the bread of life. I'm the one sent from the Father. The Lord has provided for us the true bread of life that offers eternal life. The Lord has provided for us. So don't let your present circumstances, no matter how difficult and daunting, keep you from remembering that you have life in Christ. You have life in Christ. You have redemption in Christ. You have a future home of glory through Christ. No present circumstance can change who he is, what he has done, and what he will do for us. There is no present circumstance in your life that can take away God's provision for his people. And we're going to get to tests and trials and tribulations, and we're going to want to ask the question, "Really, Lord, are you even with us anymore?" Let's not be like Israel. But let's learn to trust him and obey him in the midst of the desert wilderness that we are in. I mean, we're reliving Israel's story here. This is the whole point of 1 Corinthians 10. Go to one more text, 1 Corinthians 10. Paul here in the New Testament is explaining to us that our journey is Israel's journey. We have experienced Israel's story through Christ. 1 Corinthians 10. For I do not want you to be ignorant of the fact, brothers and sisters, that our ancestors were all under the cloud, and they all passed through the sea. They were all baptized into Moses, and in the cloud and in the sea, they all ate the same spiritual food and drank the same spiritual drink, for they drank from the spiritual rock that accompanied them, and that rock was Christ. Nevertheless, God was not pleased with most of them. Their bodies were scattered in the wilderness. Now, these things occurred as examples to keep us. These things occurred as examples for us. They occurred as examples to keep us from setting our hearts on evil things as they did. Do not be idolaters as some of them were. As it is written, the people sat down to eat and drink and got up to indulge in revelry. We should not commit sexual immorality as some of them did, and in one day 23,000 of them died. We should not test Christ as some of them did and were killed by snakes, and do not grumble as some of them did and were killed by the destroying angel. These things happened to them as examples and were written down as warnings for us on whom the culmination of the ages has come. So if you think you are standing firm, be careful that you don't fall. No temptation has overtaken you except what is common to mankind. And God is faithful. He will not let you be tempted beyond what you can bear. But when you are tempted, he will also provide a way out so that you can endure it. What's he saying? What's Paul saying in relation to this wilderness story back in Exodus? He's saying that we have experienced Israel's story through Christ. We have been led by God under cloud and through sea. We have eaten the manna and drunk from the rock because through Christ, their story becomes our story. Their journey is a shadowy foretaste of Christ and what he will do for his children, what he will do for his people, what he will do for us. So church, we are now, because of Christ, a holy nation, a royal priesthood, a people for God's own possession. So don't set your minds on evil things. Don't run after the idols of our age. Don't commit sexual immorality as they did, which led to their death, the text says. Don't test Christ. Don't grumble as they did. God is faithful. He will patiently provide, even as he has already provided. We can trust him. We can be the children of God who trust and obey his word. It is for your good and the good of those around you that you obey him. And he will help us escape the temptations of the wilderness as we endure in following him as he leads us to the promised land. This is our story. He will help us escape the wilderness as he gives us the strength to endure through the wilderness as he takes us to the promised land, the new heaven and the new earth, the new creation that God is bringing about. Even now, the Lord lovingly tests and patiently provides for his people as we learn to obey and trust him. As we learn, as his people, to obey and trust him. And every circumstance you come across and every day is going to test you, saying, trying to keep you so located in the present circumstance that you can't see that God is above our circumstances. That God has provided Jesus for us to help us in the midst of the trials and the tribulations. That God isn't someone who just says, okay, I'm just going to take you out and let's go. No, we're not escapist Christians where we're just hoping to get out of this world. Oh, I can't wait till we finally get to heaven. No, he is here teaching us what it means to be his people, teaching us what it means to be his children. He is with us. He promised through Jesus, he said, I will be with you to the end of the age. And he is with us, and he comes into our situations and our trials and our circumstances and our temptations, and he says, look, here's how you trust and follow me in this situation. Here's how you obey my word in this situation. I'm looking out for your good. I am your father. I will care for you. I will provide for you. Obey me. Trust me. That's how God is with his people. And so the question we have is, are we going to be like Israel, grumbling, complaining, doubting God's presence with us, or are we going to trust his word no matter the circumstance, knowing that he has already provided everything we need in Jesus Christ? And we can trust him moving forward. His great acts of redemption have been done, and he will complete everything he has promised. I'm going to have the band go ahead and come on up. We're going to close this time with a prayer. And it's a prayer that Jesus taught us to pray. He said, pray to me as a father. He says, we should be praying, give us this day our daily bread. Every single day, we as God's people should be expecting God to provide for us. Because he will. Just as he did the manna in the wilderness, so he has provided Christ, and so we have all we need every single day. And so let's pray this prayer together as his people, saying, Father, you are all we need.